out there in a way that can be seen by all of these initiatives. So the University of Kansas is part of VertNet, and VertNet data happen to be participating in GBIF as well. So which network are we participating in? The answer is yes. Okay? All of them. Punjab.
I just wanted to add one thing about the specific question. Another question that was, GBIF is a global network, but beyond that, why participate in GBIF? The answer is the same whether GBIF or any other network, and that is, does the network actually do something for you by participating? Now, the answer is yes. If it was only to make your data visible to the rest of the world, that visibility itself is valuable. It lets researchers in the world, policymakers in the world, conservation organizations in the world, more aware that your data exists, that your projects exist, that your institutions exist. In a sense, at a very base level, I don't want to make it seem like business, but in a sense, it's advertising, free advertising. That's just one of the things that participating in GBIF does for you. You can see that GBIF has produced all kinds of tools, on. Being part of that larger community, part of the standards, part of all these things that make biodiversity data useful in general, is a good thing.
I've understood that we have done a data cleaning before data publishing. Yeah, if maybe you may think that you have cleaned your data very well and you don't publish it. That is, you just keep just the metadata and your data now is reserved. If your data is not well cleaned, how can somebody from outside get access to your data in order to really clean the data, to be very, very clean? I don't understand. How can a person really
let's clarify your question because I sort of understand it. You are publishing only the metadata, but you're not publishing your data. Okay, so your question is your data is not clean and it's not public. So how can
clean your data? Because it doesn't have access to the data. You're reading that. How can he compare to clean your data?
All right. So nobody can clean your data unless they can get your data. So first, I would recommend trying to clean your data yourself. After this workshop, you would have some skills to be able to do that. And then I would publish as much information as you can into the public domain, which will allow people to get your data. And then once people get your data, and if they discover something that's dirty, then they can give you feedback on how to clean your data. So you can continuously receive feedback from people that are using your data, and in that way, your original data grows cleaner and cleaner. Maybe you don't have all the skills, or you just don't notice some things that are wrong with your data that other people can. So there's some benefit to putting your data into public domain and getting feedback from people that might have more knowledge, intricate knowledge about your species and other information than you. John, do you have a comment on that?
Yeah, I agree with what Kyle was saying. The data are not in the public domain. The metadata could allow a researcher to find that the data set exists and ask for it. Get the data from you if they have your permission, and then clean it as an individual. If the data were in the public domain to begin with, then lots of people would see it without having to actually ask for each time. And the likelihood of having data feedback coming back to you would be high.
The other side of the coin is that we have to be reasonable about what it is we really are planning to do with the data we collect. I one time had a student who wanted to work on the phylogeny of a particular bird group. And he wrote to a colleague of mine and asked for one tissue sample. A student had accumulated, he'd gone on expeditions, and we had gone on expeditions before he was with us, and he had accumulated dozens and dozens of tissue samples. He writes to this colleague and says, will you please send me this one sample that I'm going to collect? And the colleague writes back and says, I've been working my whole career towards the study that you're doing. From 30 years back, I've been working on this. And, you know, my feeling is, everything's got a time limit. You know, I have things that I've been working on for 20 years, and if next year I see that you published it, it'll be, hey, congratulations, that's cool. I didn't get to it. You know, so I think you as a responsible researcher, you need to also say, really being honest, I'm going to get to this, and that's long term. I can't protect that jealousy. So I think it's a two-way street. The Creative Commons license, I think, is much more generic. You're putting out data that is not within your initial immediate plans for the next few years. It is not critical data to a study that you or your students or your colleagues are working on. It's just data. You accumulate lots more data than you're ever going to publish in your life. Okay? And so you're putting those data out there, and this is just a broad umbrella protection. Okay? That's all it is. If you're worried specifically about data, then don't do that. But put out the information about it so that people at least know what you did. Kyle gave you some very good reasons why you should do that. Publish the existence of and the generalities of it. Don't put out the specifics that could hurt for your institution. Okay. Other questions?
I don't know which one of you was first.